Thanks for the invitation. This is the first time I present my work in Neuroinformatics conference. As you can understand from my title, one of the things that I'm working, apart from in general brain connectivity and machine learning and how we can extract reliable cognitive biomarkers in many various disorders and disease, I'm working on how we can define one connectivity estimator that can quantify different type of interactions that coexist in the human brain using electromagnetic recordings, and how we can incorporate different frequencies, intra-frequency coupling, cross-frequency coupling, with in amplitude domain and phase domain. And this will be my first attempt of how to incorporate all this information into one single estimator. Why connectivity? In my opinion, this is more informative and more interesting to study brain connectivity compared to regional activation. It's more informative practically, and also it can be interpreted much more easier using many neurophysiological models. And unlikely activation detection, connectivity can give you much more information about different conditions in cognitive neuroscience, in what change in brain connection during a disorder and disease. There are many types of connectivity analysis, seed-based, particularly based on fMRI, network-based, using DCM or structural equation modeling or structural vector autoregression, but my approach would be functional connectivity bivariate using symbolic transfer entropy. There are numerous of connectivity estimators and that can change the interpretation of results, like mutual information coherence, imaging power of coherence, phase-like index, Granier causality, and many others to estimate also inter-frequency coupling, like phase-locking value, modulation index presented by Tort and GLM by Van Wink. So the main issue is that even though two or more groups of people are working on the same data set using MEG resting state, let's say for Alzheimer's disease, using the same social causes or algorithm, then it's very difficult to incorporate and to find consistent results. And this is a main issue in brain connectivity analysis using neuroelectromagnetic recordings. And the second thing is that I'm working already with published work in based on meta-arithmetic task, and it's very informative. It's how to integrate all the types of interaction into a single graph, and this is very informative, and it is not just a technical issue, but it's something that can be interpreted. And here is my first attempt to try to integrate both inter- and inter-frequency coupling. This is a metal arithmetic task where I estimate the phase-locking value, phase-locking communication within theta frequency frontal areas within paroxysmal size in alpha 2, cross-frequency coupling you can see with green, and then within sensor the cross-frequency coupling. And on the right, you can see the with color then how we integrate in a functional connectivity graph with different type of interaction. This gives you a much more higher discriminative power, but also a much more interesting result in terms of interpretation and connected cognitive neuroscience with different types of interaction. And symbolic transferator was first presented by Stanek in an epileptic study where I just demonstrate that can detect the hub that propagates the seizure and demonstrate that very, very significant and very robust noise. And the whole approach is symbolic transfer entropy is based on transfer entropy on information theoretic approach, but you first you must transform your symbolic time series into symbolic sequences. And we used the delay version of symbolic transfer entropy, which is the same, but using different time lags, and by estimating the symbolic transfer entropy between two time series A and B, and B and A, and we take the difference. And if it's positive, then A drives B, or if it's negative, then B drives A. To apply surrogate analysis, you must sampling one of the two times series symbolic sequences, and then you can estimate symbolic transfer entropy in 1,000 to 10,000 times, and then you can create a distribution and you assign a p value between those two time series. And this is just a demonstration between FP1 EG signal and P7 in parietal in front of theta hyperoccipital alpha 2. And in C, you can see how delay symbolic transfer performs in different time delay samples. You can see with black crosses the significant level using this surrogate analysis. And in D, you can see if you symbolize each time series independently. And this is the most significant bad technique that we can see in literature. The dependent symbolization for each time series, that you must define embedding dimension time delay for your time series, and then you embed you reconstruct the space for each time series. For example, if you choose embedding dimension equals to 1, then you order this every sample of the time delay across the three dimensions, and this gives you 3 factorial equals to 6 possible combinations of this ordering. And then you assign, you transform your initial symbolic initial time series into symbolic time series from using symbols from 1 up to 6 that are related with this ordering. But this is problematic because it works independently for each time series. We propose then the Neuroigals algorithm. This is a famous Lorentz system that you reconstruct the both time series into the same space, and then you find common symbols between the two time series. This is a demonstration in the metal arithmetic task of 5 levels, starting from summation of two single-digit numbers up to 5, which is the summation of 2 3-digit numbers. And definitely you can see the drive of frontal theta to paraoccipital alpha 2 incorrect trials compared to wrong. Using this delay symbolic transfer entropy, we succeed to find a non-time lag equals to 0 in between left and right temporal frontal areas compared to right paraoccipital alpha 2, which is one of the issues that discriminate correct and wrong. So this is the first demonstration of this symbolic transfer entropy. So both the strength and also the time matters to discriminate correct versus wrong trials. I applied symbolic transfer entropy in an open database provided by McHill, Canada, 87 subjects from 18 up to 65, using the Electromag system, a source localized using LCMV, and using the 90 AL Atlas. I defined symbolic transfer entropy, delta symbolic transfer entropy AP, using this equation in order to describe the dominant, the preferred of flow from anterior to posterior if the delta symbolic transfer entropy range between 0.5 and 1, or from posterior to anterior between 0 and 0.5, and also a posterior anterior index average of posterior anterior row eyes in order to find the preferred information flow. In order to assign a significant value for posterior anterior index, I shuffled the average delta symbolic transfer values across posterior anterior row eyes. I repeated 10,000 times, and then I create a distribution in order to assign the p value to this posterior anterior index. The whole approach using this symbolic transfer entropy was realized independent for phase and amplitude. Using 6 predefined frequency bands, we demonstrate that in all the frequency bands, with the exception of theta, in both amplitude and phase, we can see in A amplitude, in B you can see anterior to posterior, and posterior to anterior preferential flow in both domains and across frequency bands, and this is a very significant results, even in resting state, which is important. The posterior anterior redox was very significant. You can see positive values. This is the percentage shows how how as an index of the significance of how posterior drives anterior for positive values, or anterior to posterior for the opposite. You can see only theta with minus, which means that frontal anterior theta drives posterior theta. And all four subjects were excluded as outliers from the whole cohort. The time lag, even though I estimate the whole approach in bivariate, and one can say that there are many indirect connections via third node, are all above almost 100 milliseconds. And we can see different time lag between phase and amplitude domain. As a comparison, I use phase lag index, which is very much presented by STAM, very robust volume conduction, in order to detect posterior anterior trend for phase dynamics and transfer entropy for amplitude dynamics, but I didn't succeed to detect significant values consistent across the whole cohort. Important thing is how to, my assumption, but this is not my assumption, is if two brain areas are connected, then they should be connected with one type of interaction within amplitude, within phase, within the same frequency or between two frequencies. So if we estimate using the delay symbolic transfer entropy or any other type of interaction, the connectivity between every frequency band that we selected, and also between different frequency bands, you can see the diagonal there. And this example is the delay symbolic transfer entropy within frequency bands. In the upper triangular is the cross frequency coupling. It's defined this matrix called comodulogram that can represent both inter and interface coupling. Then we can apply surrogate Bofferoni corrections, and we can. There are three cases. One, the first case is that only one survived the Bofferoni corrections. The second one is that more than two, then I selected the one with the maximum delay symbolic transfer entropy, or none survived. So this means that two brain areas are not connected, and of course we're not expected to have a full weighted graph. If you apply the same thing in our cases in our database for amplitude and phase, you can see, you clearly see even the tracing state are both within and also cross-frequency coupling, especially with delta, delta theta, delta alpha 1 or delta alpha 2, you can see the first column in both comodulograms, both matrices. And cross-frequency coupling is very important for the communication of two distant brain areas that oscillate on a dominant frequency, like frontal theta or parietal alpha 2. And it's very important also for the, as an index of maturation. And you can see that less cross-frequency coupling, for example, in normal aging, also in Alzheimer. And if we define a very simplified but very informative developmental index, if we sum the probability distribution of inter-frequency coupling, which is the upper triangular, and divided by the sum of intra-frequency coupling, which is the main diagonal, independent of phase and amplitude. And if we degrade them in four age groups, you can see a small increment between first and second, let's say, decade, and a decrement in 50 to 60 compared to 28 up to 40 in both amplitude and phase. So it's very informative to incorporate, to integrate in one single functional brain network all the different type of interactions simultaneously. And to do so, we need, apart from surrogate and statistics and false discovery rate for multiple comparison and to diminish the effect of false positive, we need to find a model or just delay symbolic transfer entropy. And because I'm working in a large database, in schizophrenia, matter of mind brain injury, Alzheimer, and this gives us a lot of power, and it's very important also to work in a more dynamic fashion. This is a preliminary result. I'm trying to add more subjects, up to 200, and also to how to combine different systems, MEG systems like CTF with Elekta, how the whole approach will differentiate, but it's just the first significant interpretation. Here are the three references based on delay symbolic entropy applied in a meta arithmetic task, the method and the results, and this a new one, how to discriminate correct from wrong trials in a meta arithmetic task. Thank you for your attention.
Thank you very much, Stavros. Questions for Stavros, please?
What is the advantage of symbolizing your time series compared to just considering the delays and working with your old time series?
It's more robust to
noise and every preprocessing step. So it's using, as you can see, that's why I adapt transfer entropy. I couldn't result in so consistent results. So it's I cannot explain, let's say, neurophysiology, why is that. But it's definitely the results demonstrate that it's more significant. For noise, we know, we applied with simulated data, but for the original data set, that's more robust to noise. And noise is, could be any type of noise, not system noise. Because of the source localization, we cannot, let's say, accurate find the sources, but it's more accurate. And also based on the discrimination, because I'm working with defined biomarkers, it's much more robust compared to using transfer entropy or any other information theoretic approach. Okay. But it should be done on a common space, not you shouldn't apply symbolization on a single time series or apply some threshold within the race. Yes.
No, I think it's getting late in the day. Thank you very much, Stavros.